Determined to spare me the indignity of further trials, Dr. Zyra and Cornelius spirit me away. We set off a week later. A special plane had been put at our disposal. We climbed to a height of about 30,000 feet. My only thought was to enjoy the view and the spectacular sight of Betelgeuse rising. The prehistoric city itself is not very different from those of the present day. We have discovered remnants of cars and traces of houses and airplanes. Although for some reason it does not occur to me, it is Times Square in New York. We encounter a man wandering through the rubble. The apes commandeer him and strap him to a chair and hook electrodes to his head. Under hypnotherapy, Soror the apes shake their head and regard this as irrelevant and pry him further. He then elaborates on the story of the past when apes and masses emerged from zoos and also the jungle and took over the human civilization. I preferred to hand the place over to my gorilla. A month ago, he ordered me to do the cooking and washing up. He began to use my plates and knives and forks. Last week, he chased me out of my bedroom. I have taken refuge in a camp with other women who are in the same plight as myself. There are some men here as well. For some time, all these monkeys, have been ceaselessly multiplying. If this goes on, they will almost outnumber us. One of the gorillas makes fun of the boss behind his back and imitates his nervous tics. What is happening could have been foreseen. A cerebral laziness has taken hold of us. No more books, even detective novels, have now become too great an intellectual effort. No more games. At the most, a hand or two of cards. Even the childish cinema does not tempt us anymore. Meanwhile, the monkeys are meditating in silence. I had found, I believe, a cure for cancer. I wanted to put it to the test. For some time, the monkeys have been reluctant to lend themselves to these experiments. Before going into George, the chimpanzee's cage, I had him held down by my two assistants. The six gorillas I was holding in reserve for the injection had escaped. A plot. They seized us. He ordered us to be tied down on the table, and the gorillas promptly obeyed him. Then he picked up this hypodermic and injected all three of us with the deadly liquid. During the night, I succeeded in forcing the bars of my cage and escaping. I have taken refuge in the camp outside the town. I was an animal tamer. I used to do an act with a dozen orangutans, magnificent beasts. Today, I'm inside the cage instead of them, together with some other circus performers. Ulysses and Nova make it back to the launch, and it lifts off back to the ship. The trip back to Earth takes about 2 years. Nova is pregnant and delivers a child they name Sirius. In the 2 years, Nova and even Sirius learn to talk well enough to form basic sentences. The launch arrives on Earth. In the daylight, they see the Eiffel Tower of Paris. Then they see the familiar site of Orly Airport in Paris, where they plan to land. The ship stops in the middle of the tarmac. In the distance, they see a jeep. Using the binocular aspect of their vision, Ulysses and Nova look again and see that emerging from the jeep is an army general. He and his friends are guerrillas. Jin looked at Phyllis and said, "It's time we turn back." Unfurling the sails again, they started for Earth. As they looked out the window at the stars, Jin touched Phyllis's nose. "They are apes!"
Don't break this heart.